piece of the Veda mantra. We will try to understand today. Draghiya ayuhu. Draghiya ayuhu. Prataram sadhanaha. Draghiya ayuhu. Prataram sadhanaha. This piece of the mantra is from Rigveda, 10.18.3, 10th mandala, 18th sukta, 3rd mantra. Draghiya ayuhu prataram dadhanaha. Draghiya ayuhu prataram dadhanaha, 10.18.3. Draghiya is long. Ayuhu, span, living. Let us live long. Draghiya ayuhu, let us live long. Prataram dadhanaha, that is very important. Dadhanaha, dudhai dharana poshanayuhu. Prataram, prataram means in the best way. Let us live long in the best way possible. Let us live long in the best way possible. On the basis of this, yes, many a time whenever somebody does namaskaram to us, we give them the ashirvada saying, Dirghayushman bhava. Dirghayushmati bhava, live long, let longevity be yours. So the same thing is here. Draghi ayuhu prataram dadhana. Let you live long with a purposeful life, by leading the life well. Now here there are so many points to understand here. Though the sentence what you have got is with few words, each word convey lot of message. Now ayuhu, ayuhu is lifespan. Now this lifespan what you have got, it can be extended, it can be pulled, it can be made longer. Here, this is a point what we have to understand. Many a time when we understand, or many time, many people who are influenced by the Puranic context, they say, lifespan is fixed. Brahma has written on your forehead that you are going to live for so many years. So it is fixed. When it's fixed, how can you live longer? It's fixed. Maybe 40 years, 50 years, 60 years, 80 years, whatever it is. What is written on your forehead, it is confirmed. There is no question of increasing the lifespan. But the Vedas are very clear that you have to live longer, you can expand your span of life. That means, it is very clear that our life span is not fixed. It is in our hands, either to cut it short or to make it longer. So the way we understand this ayu is the whole crux of the issue. We are understanding this ayu as number of years of our living. Of course, even Vedas say, and on the basis of Veda, in Yoga Darshana we have got one sutra, there also it says. This I have referred many times, once again. Sati mule tad vipako. Sati mule tadvipako jatyayur bhogaha. Jatyayur bhogaha. When the result of our karma, that is karma phala, is pending, yes, we will be in the birth and death cycle. And depending upon what is there as karma phala. We will be given our jati ayu bhoga. Sati mule tadvipako jati ayur bhoga. Jati ayu bhoga. We are given our jati, we are given our ayu, we are given our bhoga. And this is a good point to keep in mind and try to understand this Veda Mantra. Or in the later Veda Mantra, you can understand that Yoga Darshana Sutra, both are okay. Now when I say jati, it never refers to caste as we are understanding today. This is very, very clear. This we should be able to understand without any confusion. Jati is not caste. Instead, jati is to be understood as species. Species. Prani varga. Prani prabheda. It's very simple. The present day caste system, wherever it is. In India, we call it a caste system. Elsewhere, they call it as blacks and whites. And there are so many such discriminative factors which divide the society. The society should have been one. This human society should have been one. But for different reasons, it has been split into fragments. In one place it is caste, in one place it is the color of the skin, black, white. In some places, they say natives and invaders, so many things. And there are caste systems elsewhere also in different names. In the name of religion, and within the religion they have got subgroups. Mm-hmm. Protestant, Catholics, Sunni, Shia, so many things. Now if we understand, try to understand these things closely, we find that most of them are man-made and are derogatory for the progress of the human society. Man-made. It's a man-made discrimination and enforced upon people where some people think they are highly born, some people are low born, and the high born people exploit the low born. There is no love, there is no friendship between all human beings. It's disturbed very much. We are finding such racial discrimination, we are finding that racial war almost everywhere on the globe. It's a very sorry aspect of it. We have an answer for this problem only in the Vedic concept. It says, all of us, all human beings belong to one jati. And that jati is to be understood as species. And the species we all belong to is one, that is human beings. Scientifically, we are also called as Homo sapiens. We belong to one species called Homo sapiens. No further discrimination whatsoever. But depending upon, this is also a natural classification, it's not man-made. In this natural classification, what happens is, in this human society, people get identified based on their attitudes, aptitudes, and professions. Guna, karma, sabhava, samarthya. It's a natural classification, it's not man-made. In any society for that matter, in any human society, this happens. And they are segregated as, or they are identified as, Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. Now once again I repeat, this Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra is not caste. Is a way of life they choose depending upon their guna, karma, swabhava, samarthya. On their nature, aptitude, and capacity. And this can be chosen. It's not forced upon any person by birth. This varna is something which can be chosen by the person concerned depending upon their capacity, aptitude, etc. Another very important thing in the light of Vedas is Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, all are equal. Nobody is superior, nobody is inferior. Clearly it says, Ajyeshthaso Akanishthasaha. There is no one among you, the species of human beings, superior. There is no one among you in a species of human beings who is inferior. All are equal and you are like brothers, and if you want to progress, you have to practice together. Vavrutuhu Sobhagaya. You move ahead for your progress together. All of you are equal. Nobody is inferior, nobody is superior. This is a Vedic dictum. It's very clear. So when you are looking at things in the light of the Vedas, yes, there is no confusion, there is utter clarity. So, except all of us, we belong to human beings, one species, one jati, and a natural classification next to it is Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, where all are equal, nobody is superior, inferior. There is no scope for anyone trying to exploit the other. It's not allowed. We have to progress together, we have to love one another, we have to feel brotherly among ourselves. So when you speak of jati here, we should be very, very clear that it is nothing but one human race. We belong to one human sect. There's only one sect, that's human beings. The next one is the one which is relevant to our discussion now, that is Ayu. So we get our species, whether we have to take birth as human beings or maybe any other species of animals, Pashu, Pakshi, Krimi, Kita. So that is dependent on our karma phala, which is yet to be enjoyed. So whatever karma phala is there yet to be experienced, yes, we get our jati. Next one is Ayu. Now here only all the confusion is there. Many of us, we understand Ayu as the number of years we are supposed to live. No. There is no limitation for the number of years. It's very simple to understand. Suppose if our life is determined in terms of years, then what's the meaning of this sentence, Vedic sentence? Draghi Ayu Prataram Dhanata. Make your life longer. It becomes meaningless. Dirghayushman Bhava becomes redundant. Dirghayushmati becomes foolish, because it cannot happen. Because number of years that you have to live is predetermined. No. Vedas cannot speak nonsense, and the practice of wishing longer life also is full of meaning. So it should be very clear. So when I say Ayu, it is not, I repeat, it is not in terms of years we have to understand this Ayu. Ayu should never be calculated in terms of years, because it cannot be expanded. The span of life cannot be elongated. But here it says very clearly, it is possible for you to elongate, to make your life longer, to make your span longer. Longevity is permissible, is possible. So then how we have to understand this Ayu? This Ayu is to be understood as capacity of the instrument that is given to us. The Sharira Indriya Manas is given to us as a tool, and the life of this tool in terms of capacity is to be understood as Ayu, not in terms of years. Should be very clear for us. See, it's very simple. Say I have got a vehicle, a four-wheeler, a car. If I ask you, what's the life of this car? The answer is very simple. Sir, we cannot say it. It depends upon how we use it. If I use the car with proper maintenance, yes, I'll be able to use this car for more number of years. If I make a rough use of this vehicle, then it cannot give me service for longer years. Very fast it deteriorates and will become a scrap. So I cannot say how many years, but it depends upon the way we use it. In the same way, this is a tool, what is given to us, this Sharira Indriya Manas. If I use it properly, maintain it properly, yes, it can give service for more number of years. On the other hand, if we use it roughly, if I misuse it, if I abuse it, yes, the number of years for which it can give the service will come down. So it depends upon how we use it, how we maintain it. So if the maintenance and use is good, it will be for longer years. And if the maintenance and use is not right, the span will be less and lesser. So when I say Ayu, we have to understand in this way, only then there is scope for increasing the span or decreasing the span. Now it clearly says increase the span, Draghi Ayu. Not only in this mantra, there are many mantras where they speak of this Draghi Ayu. That the span of life be increased. There is scope. To increase the span or to decrease the scope, it is in our hands. It depends on how we maintain this tool, the Sharir Indra Manas, this apparatus, this machinery, this vehicle, whatever you call it. Now comes the next question. By doing what? Or how, by maintaining it, in which way it is possible for us to expand the span, increase the span of life? By doing what, the span of life will be shortened? That's the next question. The first thing is to maintain it. So if you maintain this instrument, well, it gives service for a longer period. Now for that they speak of Yukta Ahara, Yukta Vihara, Yukta Vichara. Ahara, Vihara, Vichara. Or Vichara, Ahara, Vihara. Vichara, Ahara, Vihara. These are the three important inputs which are required for running of this machinery. And if we take care of these three, Vichara, Ahara and Vihara, yes, we can maintain this instrument better. What is this Vichara? First one, Vichara. We can think in two ways. One is selfish, one is broad. We can be narrow-minded, we can be broad-minded. Now this instrument is in such a way, is manufactured in such a way that a broad-minded Vichara will maintain it for a longer time. Broad-minded Vichara. Vichara is thinking, thoughts. As our thoughts are broad and noble, yes, we can live longer. If our thoughts are narrow, if our thoughts are selfish, that kills the span of life. That spoils the span of life. Now what is narrow-minded, broad-minded, selfless, selfish? Selfless, selfish, yes, we can understand. On the basis of it, we can define narrow and broad. Whenever I think of my welfare, that's natural. That's animal-like. Every animal thinks of its own welfare, its own protection, its own existence, its own propagation. It's natural for any animal. Self-preservation and self-propagation. Two basic needs, two basic instincts. If we also stop at that, then we are no human beings, but we are any other animal. Now this does not sustain the machinery. This does not maintain the machinery for a longer time. So of course, self-preservation is there, but beyond that, we have to think of the preservation of the whole human race. We have to think of the welfare of the whole human society. Because you are part of that society. So every thought of mine, if it is directed towards the well-being of the society in the world, as that I can call it as a broad-minded thought. విశాల విచార ఉదార విచార. అండ్ దిస్ సార్ట్ ఆఫ్ థింకింగ్ యాడ్స్ ఇయర్స్ టు మై లైఫ్. ఇట్స్ పాసిబుల్ దాట్ ది లైఫ్ స్పాన్ కెన్ బి ఎక్స్టెండెడ్. దెన్ ఆహార, దట్స్ ఆల్సో ఎన్ ఇన్పుట్ ఫర్ దిస్ శరీర ఇంద్రియ మనస్. So when I take the right food at the right time, in the right way, yes, the machinery will function properly for a longer time. The basic food prescribed, I repeat, prescribed for human beings is a vegetarian food. I got one piece of the Veda mantra where it says, Krishincha sasyincha మనుష్య ఉపజీవంతి, కృషించ సస్యంచ మనుష్య ఉపజీవంతి. దీస్ హ్యూమన్ బీయింగ్స్ లివ్ డిపెండింగ్ ఆన్ కృషి ఇస్ అగ్రికల్చర్, సస్య ఇస్ వెజిటేషన్. అగ్రికల్చర్ అండ్ వెజిటేషన్ ఇస్ ద మెయిన్ సోర్స్ ఆఫ్ ఫుడ్ ఫర్ ఆల్ హ్యూమన్ బీయింగ్స్. అవర్ హ్యూమన్ స్ట్రక్చర్ ఈజ్ ఆల్సో మ్యానుఫ్యాక్చర్డ్ ఇన్ సచ్ ఎ వే దట్ ఇట్ ఈస్ పాసిబుల్ ఫర్ ద స్ట్రక్చర్ టు అసిమిలేట్ వెజిటేరియన్ ఫుడ్ వెల్. The purpose of eating food is to regenerate energy for doing your work. And the energy can be liberated or generated in this system with the input being vegetation, vegetarian food. That's how the whole instrument, the whole digestive system is prepared. Of course, we can also adjust with any other kind of food, but that is not natural to us. Why it is not natural? Because the very nature of the human being is compassion. This you are discussing in the previous one. Compassion. No other animal can feel this compassion. They got their own limitations. Compassion needs the way we look at things. We should be able to imagine the pain and pleasure of the other living being. Only that is called as compassion. So that capacity to imagine, that capacity to experience somebody's pain or pleasure is possible only this human machinery. No other machinery can do it. So compassion is the very feature of human beings. And if it is a non-vegetarian food, compassion is totally out. Only in vegetarian food, compassion has a place, has a role to play. కృషించ సస్యంచ మనుష్య ఉపజీవంతి. ఇన్ అనదర్ మంత్ర ఇట్ సేస్ అన్నపతే అన్నస్య నోదే హనీమస్య శుష్మనః ప్రప్రదాతరం తరిష ఊర్జం నోధీహి ద్విపదే చతుష్పదే. లెట్ ఆల్ క్రీచర్స్ ద్విపదే చతుష్పదే బైపెడ్ అండ్ క్వాడ్రపెడ్, లెట్ ఆల్ ది ఎనిమల్స్ గెట్ దేర్ ఫుడ్, get their energy. That's a prayer. So to get my energy, if I'm going to kill other animals, it is redundant, it is meaningless. Of course I need food, I cannot survive without food, right? But for the sake of my food, if I'm to kill another animal, that is not compassionate, that is not humane. So whenever I speak of food, it definitely means vegetarian food in the light of Vedas, and no other food comes into its ambit. And this food also, I can take it in different ways. Raw as it is, that's number one, raw, take the food raw. Second one is cooked food. Third one is cooked food, lot of spices, spicy food. All are vegetarian only. Here also they have got different effects and grades. The cooked food with lot of spices is very dangerous and is not healthy. But our tongue feels it wonderfully well. We are eating not for the tongue, we are eating for energy. That's the third great food. The second great food is cooked food with minimum spices. Once again, vegetarian only. That is second grade. First grade is the vegetarian food taken as it is, a raw food, raw vegetables, raw fruits, sprouts and other things. Raw, no cooking. We can experiment, we need not believe all these things. More raw food we take, more energetic we will be. Cooked food we take less, cooked food with spices, we have got different problems. One simple example, if the food what to take is very hot, using those chilies and other things, it will have a negative effect on our whole digestive tract. The probability of getting ulcers will be more because of that spicy nature. Whereas if it is a raw food, fruits and vegetables, that would be excellent. Now what we call it? The food which is raw, that is called a sattvic food. And the food which is with spices and other things, we call them as tamasic food or rajasic food. Sattvika, tamasa, rajasa. Now each has got its own impact on our system. And one sutra from the Ayurveda, Ayurveda is the science of life, which is a branch out from the Vedas, Upaveda you can call it. There they give a small formula for this to understand. Sattvam jnanam, tamaha ajnanam, raga dvesho rajaha. It's very simple to remember. If you want knowledge, the input has to be sattvic food. Sattvam jnanam. We don't want knowledge, tamaha ajnanam. Tamasic food results in ajnana. Being understanding, knowledge will be dulled in case of tamasic. Raga dvesho rajaha. When you take rajasa food, our emotions will be at its extremes. Too happy, too depressed. The fluctuation of our emotions will be too much. It will be in a balance, it will be in an equilibrium when we are speaking of sattvic food. Sattvam jnanam. So among these three types of food, sattvic food is the best. That is vegetarian food, raw. That's with reference to the food. Not only that, there are so many things. Just in a nutshell, I'm telling you. So whenever we take food, we should be careful enough to select it rightly without harming anyone and eating it. Then we got vihara. Vihara is our other activities. So our other activities also contribute to the longevity of this machinery. So let these activities of ours be prompted by, motivated by the thought which I told you just now, yukta vichara and yukta ahara. So that's at the base, then vihara also will be comfortable and easy. If the basic two things are not there, the whatever activity we do will be under stress, will be under pressure, will be under tension, will be under anxiety. And that spoils the capacity of the instrument. Will not be able to maintain it for a longer period. So this machinery what is given to us has got its own capacity. It's in terms of capacity we understand span, and this capacity may be increased or decreased depending upon our ahara, vichara, vihara. So they are all interlinked. Now it says very clearly, if the span of life has to be increased, it's possible. We can add years to our life. This is possible only when we practice the right way of thinking, right food and right activities. Yukta vichara, yukta ahara, yukta vihara. So when we say dragi ayuhu, let your span of life be elongated, be expanded, it means please indulge yourself in good thoughts, good food and good activities. So indirectly it is telling the same thing. That's ayu. Ayu is in terms of capacity. A small example we will take. It's a usual common example what I give, which I already given several times. That is say, we are given with one organ of our body, say heart. Now for how many years this heart works? No, it's not in terms of years. It's only in terms of its capacity. Say it is given the capacity to tick, pulsate, say for 5 crore times. That one example, 5 crore times. That is the capacity. Now this capacity, I can use it in 2 ways. One way, be anxious, be under stress, be under fear, lead an irregular, indisciplined life. Now what will happen to this heartbeat? Lub dub, lub dub, lub dub, lub dub. It works fast because of stress and other so many things. And all the 5 crore beats, what is there for this particular heart, its capacity, it will be over by the 50th year. Done. On the contrary, if the same heart is used in this way, be calm, be pleasant, be happy, be laughing, take the life in a sportive spirit, then what will happen to this? Love every creature around you. Then the heartbeat will be love, dub, love, dub. It will be in a lesser pace. And the same 5 crore, I can use it for some 80 to 90 years. Because the speed is reduced. Now it is in my hands. It's in my hands. Whether to increase the number of beats of the heart or to reduce it. If I reduce it, I live longer. If I don't reduce it, my life will be shorter. That is, the given capacity can be used in a way where it will get expanded or where it will be shortened. It's in my hands. It depends upon the way of life I live. So draghi ayuhu means let your life get expanded, therefore lead such a life where it is free from stress, tension, frustration, hate, jealousy, over desires. So remove all those things. Life becomes simple. Life becomes easy. Sportive spirit, laughing, dancing, loving every creature around you. The heartbeat will be less and you can live for a longer life. And this way of leading the life is called as prataram. Prataram is usefully, in the best way, dadhanaha. Have a life which is capable of giving all these results. And that life is called as the real, useful, purposeful life. So lead a purposeful life. Lead a life with noble thoughts, noble goals. And use the instrument what is given to you in a very, very diligent way and live longer. Draghi ayuhu prataram dadhana. You don't plan your life. If you make your life haphazard, if you make your life full of hatred, enmity, tension, depression, frustration, then that is not the way of life that you are supposed to lead. Then what will happen? The whole lifespan will get short-circuited and we will end up in death in early years. If we have to live longer, then we have to be sportive, we have to be loving, we should have noble goals, we should have good food system, so many things. Do it, it's possible, and live longer. So live longer means lead such a way of life. Such a pious way of life, such a noble way of life. Now living longer is very, very crucial. That's another thing which we have discussed in the previous one. Kurvanniveha karmani jijivishe chatam samaha. We should wish to live, we should will to live for 100 years and beyond 100 years, because it's a rare opportunity we have got as human beings. every moment I can make use of for the improvement of the soul in terms of its strength and in terms of its purity. So every minute is useful to me. So making my life longer is very crucial for me, and for that I have to lead such a way of life that is prataram dadhana, a good way of life, a humanitarian way of life, and it will increase the number of years. And in those increased number of years and moments, yes, I do good thoughts, good action, good food, and the result of it is increased strength of the soul and increased purity of the soul. It's all interlinked. You have heard of this. There is no meaning in adding years to my life, but I should add life to my years. See, I may live for any number of years, but I should really live, I should add life to it. Adding life to years is more important, and of course, adding year to life is also important, but the primary thing is adding life to our years. So it's a balance. Dragiyayo prataram dadhanaha is a sentence where it balances between, where it speaks of an equilibrium between the life and the quality of life. Adding years to life is equally important, and more than that, adding life to years is still more important. There's a balance between you. Dragiyayo, that is a life we expanded with prataram dadhanaha, by adding life to the years. It's a piece of the Veda mantra, Rigveda 10.18.3. It's not that I have spoken of everything. It's not that I have explained everything. Subject to my limitation, I have shared a few thoughts. But if you think about it, yes, you'll be able to understand the importance of life, in particular this human life, and what we have to achieve. And to achieve it, how this tool has to be maintained, that is Sharira Indriya Manas. And to be careful about everything which will spoil its longevity, which will disturb its longevity. Every thought of ours, we have to check it, whether it will increase the longevity or not. Every word what we utter, we have to see whether it will add to our years and life to our years. And every action we do, we have to check it. Every food we take, we have to check it. If it is possible for us to understand the process and check it at every moment, what we do, what we think, what we eat, what we talk. Yes, it's possible for us to maintain this instrument for a longer period and achieve the strength of the soul and the purity of the soul, which is possible only in human life. Repeat, it's possible only in human life, and in any other form of living, non-human form, this is not possible at all. It's impossible. It's a rare opportunity what I've got as human beings. So we have to add years to our life, and more than that, add life to our years. Draghiyayuhu prataram dadhanam. Okay, next one. Priyam shraddhe. Priyam shraddhe dadataha. Priyam shraddhe dadataha. Priyam shraddhe dadataha. A piece of the Veda mantra from Rigveda 10.151.2. Priyam shraddhe dadataha. Shraddhe, that's in the vocative case, sambodhana vibhakti. O shraddhe, e shraddhe, dadataha priyam. Now, Shraddha is a very important word that we have to understand. Usually, Shraddha is understood as belief or faith, generally. But the very word Shraddha doesn't mean belief or faith, because belief or faith can be in any right things, wrong things, true things, false things. It could be in anything. But when you speak of Shraddha, the very word is derived like this, Shrat plus Dha. Shrat plus Dha. Dha is Dudhai Dharana portion, you have to hold on to support, to take it to heart. Shrat means Satyam. Shrat iti Satyam. Shrat iti Satyam. So when I speak of Shraddha, it means a belief or faith in truth and truth only. This is very important. It's not believing any X, Y, Z. If you believe in anything, it could be belief, it could be faith. But in speaking of Shraddha, it means belief or faith in truth and truth only. When I speak of Shraddha, before Shraddha, our investigation, our seeking for truth should have taken place. I should have sought for this truth. I would have investigated for truth. And only after finding out that it is truth, yes, I believe in it. I place my faith in it. That is Shraddha. If I just use the word faith or belief, it could be a blind belief. It could be an ignorant faith. It could be in something which is not true. So Shraddha is a strong word, and it demands our effort to find out truth, to investigate truth. Satyanveshana is a prerequisite for Shraddha. If you are not able to discover truth, there is no question of Shraddha at all. Before Shraddha, discovery of truth, Satyanveshana, will go ahead. Now the question comes, what is truth? The truth is, for one person is something, and truth for the other person is something. It varies from person to person. What one person understands as truth may not be truth for the other person, because it depends upon their experience, their knowledge, and so many things. Now the whole problem here is, when we are speaking of truth, we are thinking on the individual plinth, and it is subjective. But truth is not subjective, it is objective. This is what I understand. The subjectivity while discovering the truth has to be overcome. And we should be able to understand the objectivity. Only then we will be closer to truth. We will be able to understand truth. Truth is never subjective. It never depends upon one's experience, one's knowledge. It is something beyond that. It's very, very objective in nature. That is truth. Now, how do you understand this objectivity? One very simple definition, we can take it for it. That which is true for all, or that which is the same for all, to be precise, which is the same for all, at all places, and at all times, is the same. That you can define it as truth. Truth is something which is same for all, sarvajanika, same at all places, sarvadeshika, and same at all times, sarvakalika. Truth doesn't vary from person to person. Understanding of truth may be different from person to person, depending upon their samskara, prejudices, experience, knowledge, so many things. But truth is not dependent on one's point of view, one's opinion. It's beyond that. Whether the person likes it or not, knows it or not, truth is truth. That's objectivity. Sarvajanika. Sarvadeshika. It holds good at all places in the same way. It doesn't vary from place to place. At all places, it's the same. That's what we call it. Sarva Deshika. Desha is place. Then Sarva Kalika, it holds good at all times. It's not something yesterday, something today, and something else tomorrow. No. It is the same at all times, past, present, and future. Yes, there are such things. There are such things. We should be able to identify such nature of things, that nature of thoughts, that nature of rules and regulations around us, and that is the discovery of truth. One very, very basic, simple example I will give you. Fire burns. It's a physical example of time. Fire burns, is it truth? Now let us check. It's the same for all. Anybody, if they place their hand in the fire, it hurts, it burns. There is no exception for it. It may be an elderly person, it's a small child. A person may place their hand knowingly or unknowingly, accidentally. Fire burns. There's no exception for it. I don't like it, place your hand, it will hurt you. I like it, place your hand, it hurts you. Okay, then, at all places, yes, wherever fire is there, yes, it hurts, it burns. There is no exception or there is no place where fire doesn't hurt. Fire hurts wherever it is. Then at all times, yes, thousands of years ago also the fire was burning, hurting. Today also it does the same thing. Even after thousands of years, the same thing continues. It's not my opinion. It's not my understanding. Whether I understand it rightly or wrongly, it burns. It hurts. Whether I like it or not, it hurts. Whether I know it or not, it hurts. It doesn't depend upon the opinion or it doesn't depend upon the feeling of any person. It hurts is the nature of that fire, which is independent of the feeling of the person, the opinion of the person. And it holds good for all, the same way, at all places and at all times. So fire hurts is a truth, which is beyond subjectivity. Now this is an objective understanding of it. Let us think of another example, another physical example I'm telling. Say here in India, we have got a currency, rupee note. Now this rupee note has got its own value. Actually, it's not exactly the note with value, it is a promissory note. Just an example I'm giving. I promise to pay the bearer the sum of so and so. Okay. That's printed on it. And that is a legal tender which it can exchange for goods and services. Now, does that have the same value for all the people? It has the same value for the people who are in the territory of India. Beyond that, it has no value. If I take this rupee note and try to give it as a legal tender in America, they'll just not accept it. It's not a legal tender there. So it's not there for all people. It's not there at all places. And it also doesn't hold it at all times. Even in India. Just an example. Say on fine day, the Reserve Bank of India, the government, it says, we have demonetized it. There's no value. It has no value. It loses its value. Recently it happened. All of you know it. So even the value of that rupee note within the territory of India itself is not guaranteed. It may have a value today and tomorrow it may become a scrap, become a piece of paper. So the value carried by a rupee note is not true. It's not truth. But you speak of the value carried by a piece of gold is something different. Now even there I have told you, even the gold, it has got two values. One is the face value or the market value, other one is the intrinsic value. So with reference to the gold, the intrinsic value is true. As the properties of gold is the same to all the people. all places and at all times. The properties of gold remains the same. But the market value may vary. Maybe one place where we get a lot of gold, the rate may be less. Where it is in scarcity, the rate may be high. One day it will be so many dollars or rupees, in another place it may be so many dollars or rupees, and time to time it changes. Now the market value of it is not the same. So market value is not a truth. But the intrinsic value, which depends upon the properties of the gold, yes, that is always true. It holds good always. Compared to rupee note, gold is better. And even that gold, when I understand it in terms of its intrinsic value or the properties, yes, that is more real and more truthful. So like this, we should be able to identify or differentiate what is true, what is not true. A very simple example or a very simple definition for it is that which is the same for all, at all places and at all times is truth. So every thought that comes to us, every idea that comes to us, everything that comes to us, we should be able to identify its truth content, truth factor, whatever you call it. And after discovering the truth content of it, if I believe in it, if I take my decision, if I understand it in the same way, that is called as Shraddha. Without doing all these things, if I just believe, it is no Shraddha, but it is Andha Vishwasa, blind belief. It's a blind belief. So now, this piece of Veda mantra is addressed to Shraddhe. O Shraddhe, Dadataha Priyam. Dadataha is Dudai Dane. Dudai Dane. One who gives, one who shares. So for that person, one who shares, one he gives, O Shraddhe, you become Priyam. Priya means lovable, likable. So a person who gives, who shares, let him be liked by Shraddha. Let him be loved by Shraddha. Priyam Prinane, that is Priyam. So this Shraddha and sharing or giving go together. This giving or sharing is a truth, is a truth. All of us, knowingly or unknowingly, we are all in a big chain of give and take. We take so many things, we will be giving so many things. But here we have got one small problem. That is consciously, I am speaking of consciously, we are very, very much interested and happy while taking. But when it comes to the question of giving, yes, we have got our own problems. We are not liberal. We are not truthful. We want to hold on to things what we have received, and we are miserly while giving it. But if the chain of give and take has to function properly, we should be as liberal in taking and as liberal in giving also. We have to keep the chain of give and take running smoothly. So the Dadataha is a person who is capable of keeping that cycle moving, keeping that wheel moving of that give and take. And he knows very well that only when this wheel rotates, yes, we can generate wealth, we can live happy. It's a great principle of economics. It's a great principle of economics. And that's a truth. And let this truth be realized by everyone, in particular those who have got the tendency to share and give. And they keep this whole wheel of give and take running. Lot of cycles are there. We have got these cycles at the physical level, we have got all these cycles in the intellectual level, we have got all these cycles in the spiritual level. At all the three levels it's there. Physical level it's very easy. Say water cycle. A rain pours down, runs in rills and rivers, and joins the ocean, the sea, and it gets evaporated. They form the clouds, and the clouds again rain. Now this is a big cycle which is going on. Another cycle, plants give out oxygen. They take carbon dioxide in. We as human beings and other creatures, we take oxygen and give out carbon dioxide, which is the input for trees and plants. This is again interdependency, a cycle of give and take. Like this, we have got hundreds of cycles which are running in the nature at the physical level. In the same way, at the intellectual level also it happens. We are not born intelligent, but we are given the potential to understand things and know things. As a small infant, we knew nothing. Everything was in very, very subtle way. Now gradually we started learning. Our elders taught us this and that. They gave us a lot of inputs, information, knowledge, and shared their experience. We took it. And as we grow old, what we do? We pass it on to our next generation. One is taking and the other one is giving. So any transaction for that matter, we take some service, pay for it. We take a good and pay for it. So give and take. Now as long as the cycle of give and take runs properly and smoothly, yes, the whole economy will be very healthy. It's a very big process. Here, the stress is, the emphasis is on giving. Because only when there is a giver, there can be a taker. If there are no givers, there are no takers. Giving should start. That's a starting point. So if a person likes giving, likes sharing, yes, this whole cycle will work. And this whole cycle is what is called as Shraddha. It's a truth. It's a truth. This give and take cycle is the truth. It runs eternally. It runs eternally at all the three levels. Spiritual level, this is what we are discussing just now. To feel for the welfare of the whole society, all creatures on this planet. So we give that love, we give that support. And of course, we get that support also. It's a give and take. We work for the welfare of the society. Society in turn helps everyone who are in the society, and of course, we are also part of it. So this giving has to be understood as an ultimate truth, and that should become close to our heart. Priyam Shraddhe Dadataha, one who is in the position of giving. Let him give it. Whatever he can give in the best way possible, let it be given. It's pulling. And we pull all our efforts, all our resources, and from that pull, we take whatever is necessary for us. We are not grabbing. We are not stealing. We are not fighting for it. We pull down, take our needs. I cannot pull everything what I have. Certain things are limited. I can pull only a certain things depending upon my capacity and my production. Other people are capable of producing certain other things which I need. So when you pull it, the whole system works well. I contribute and take from there whatever I need. Need, I repeat, not greed. Whatever I need, I take it. Whatever I have contributed, maybe somebody else needs it and they will take it. So in this pooling and taking, in this giving and taking, if you are able to monitor it very well, then everyone would have contributed something and every one of us would have received what we need. Life becomes so simple and happy. That is sharing. That is cooperation. Now where it will start? In pooling, in contributing what I can. And more than that, I should be able to understand that this is the truth and this works well for the welfare of the individual and for the welfare of the society. In almost every application of the Vedic rites, we say, idanna mama, idanna mama. It's given, it's not mine. It's given, it's not mine. So this tendency of contributing, this tendency of sharing, this tendency of giving is the ultimate truth for the smooth running of the society and the life at all the three levels, physical, intellectual and spiritual. We give love. Only a person who can give love can expect love. And they get it. They get it. So getting love is not a starting point. Giving love is a starting point. Love every creature around you. Share everything with others. And in the same way, they will also reciprocate and you get what you need. It should start from me. It should start from me. I contribute and get what I want. While giving, give it liberally. While taking, take what you need. That's all. If there is something extra, let it be there in the pool. Let it be there in that common arena. Let it be there. It's available always. None of us you are grabbing. None of us you are taking beyond our need. Then always the resources will be available for us to consume when we need it. Another Veda mantra says, Shatahasta Samahara, Sahasrahasta Sankira. You earn and gain as though you have got 100 hands, not 1 or 2, 100. If I have got 100 hands, how I earn? Earn like that, get it. Then the second part is important. Sankira, distribute it, share it, give it as I got Sahasrahasta Sankira, as I got 1,000 hands. So here again, the emphasis is on giving. Only when you give, the wheel of give and take will run smoothly. With mere taking, as it is happening today, every one of us were grabbing and grabbing the expert in nature to the best extent possible and amassing wealth, all of which we are never going to use in our lifetime. We are just amassing it, amassing. Thinking that tomorrow I need it. If something happens tomorrow, how I can get? So in the name of security, in the name of securing our future, in the name of securing our old age problems and requirements, we amass wealth so much, which is not used 100%. It's a waste. Instead of keeping it with us, if we keep it in the common pool, that would be excellent. It will be available always for all of us. Nobody will experience a scarcity or shortage. So giving is very important, and this give and take is the truth. And if that truth is understood by us, then we never hesitate to give. We'll be liberal in giving. And always there will be something for us to take whenever we are in need. This principle and this system has to come into existence. This is very, very humane system. And this is the truth. That is why the word is used here, Shraddha. Oh, this belief in this system, in this belief, in this truth, let giving be liked by everyone. Let giving take place with love and affection. Let us share. Let us contribute. Let us keep the chain of give and take running. Priyam Shraddhe Dadataha. Priyam Shraddhe Dadataha. So you should all have that attitude to share, to give. And let us not worry. Let us not worry whether we get it back or not. Many a time we are confused. Okay, I give here and I expect to get it back from the very source where I have given. No. It's a big chain. Give somewhere, get it somewhere. It's possible. You should be able to realize the truth and how the system of give and take works. It works in a wonderful way, provided we play our role well. And what is our role to play? To give. Liberally, happy, with all love and affection, we give it. In all the three levels, physically, intellectually, and spiritually, you give it. It will come to you manifold from different sources, and our needs will be satisfied. Every one of us, we should feel this, we should understand this truth, realize this truth, discover this truth, and do it. Priyam Shraddhe Dadataha Dudai Dane. So if you understand this, yes, it works, it works. Many have experimented and they have been successful in their life. Should be giving and it will come to us manifold whenever we need it. To believe in it, now this is not blind belief, this is Shraddha. To believe in it because that's the truth, that's how the whole cycle of give and take works. to believe in that working, this functioning of this give and take is what is required. And give liberally. Give liberally. And let that giving be priya to us. Is something which we can enjoy. Enjoy giving. What you need, you will get it. That's the principle of give and take, and believe in it. Now this is not blind belief. It's not blind belief. It is belief in truth. It works. Okay, thank you for the day. We shall see other pieces of Veda Mantras in the next classes.